friends. What happened to English literature after 1950s? I would like to call it as hybridization of English literature. Somehow, a literary text was forced to renounce its nativity and traverse a very zigzag road where it met with scholars from different areas. It welcomed their opinions and judgments, and unable to hold the pain, the pressure, and of course the ecstasy, somewhere it escaped into the space, never to be found in the native back again. What? I would like to explain it like this. With the coming of new historicism as a theory in English literature, a literary text was kept open for so many social sciences around it to have a discourse on it. For example, a person or a scholar from socio-economic area could give his discourse on it, or a psychoanalytic person could discuss it, or a person from gender studies come and intervene, or a lady from a feminism come and ask a few questions there. So it had to answer also, it had to literally face all these interrogations from various social areas. So naturally I would call it as a kind of a hybridization of a literary text. It so happened that with the introduction of new criticism, scholars from various areas across the globe were invited to the American universities to discuss a few important literary texts of English, and these scholars from various areas had to pass their resolutions, had to pass their opinions on those texts. So imagine how this text was not only studied, but its areas were literally questioned, and there was a kind of a strange interaction between various social sciences on a particular text of literature, on many texts of literature. So since then, it was not an independent entity. So a person of this kind from other area came to venture into the literary arena. So he was Jacques Derrida, a French philosopher who wanted to speak something about a new theory into the study of English literature. He came up with his theory of deconstruction, and this is what we are briefly going to discuss today. Deconstruct means look at a text with respect to its inadequacies. In the sense, what are the deficiencies that you find in a text? So this was the motive of the deconstructionists. So now, it is not that easy to understand deconstruction as an independent theory. We have to compare and contrast it with the age-old tradition of literary criticism that we had till the coming of T.S. Eliot, somewhere up to 1920s. Now, we have the traditional criticism on one side, and on the other side, we have the deconstruction theory. Now, how we would look at it? So, when we come to the traditional area of criticism, you have a text which is bound from the beginning till the end in a strange and a beautiful network which cannot be separated. Any piece from this network or from this knitting cannot be taken out. And this kind of a network goes and reaches the center. And when it reaches the center, there is a kind of a single meaning. So it is a kind of a circumference wherein the writer, the reader, and the critical analyst swim together in the same river towards one particular area, which they called as the truth of that literary text. That is the meaning of the literary text. So this is how a literary text was seen from the traditional point of view. But what is this that the deconstructionists do? So they do not think that a literary text is a kind of an associated thing. So the associations that were found in the traditional area become dissociations here. That is, each little thing or every part of the structure is taken out. It's torn from its center. It is studied independently. So there is nothing like a network or going together. And Derrida questions because he comes from the philosophical background, he questions what is truth and where does it lie. So he is based on his, a kind of logical thinking which he enforced upon a literary study. Since there is no truth, since there is no center, he talks about logocentrism. There is no center in a literary study. There is no a center point of meaning in a literary text. So he wants the deconstructionist theorists to dismantle or come out of the text and then study it from the non-central areas. So there is no center, there is no single meaning. Instead, there are multiple layers of meaning because each bit is studied in a separate entity. So the association becomes a dissociation. So the center doesn't exist in the deconstructionism. So there is no single meaning that we find is not found here. And now, after the text was read and analyzed by the critics in the traditional era or in the classical form, which was based on mimesis or representation, the book was considered to be a kind of a rich product. But in the same way, a book, a literary text for the deconstructionists was considered as full of inadequacies. So these were the major differences between the traditional outlook towards a literary text and the deconstructionist outlook towards a literary text. So keeping these things into consideration, a deconstructionist named as Peter Barry came with three principles of studying deconstruction. For example, if I want to approach a literary text from the deconstruction point of view, how would I be approaching that text? So the first level he introduces as the verbal level. Now you have to read the book and benchmark certain confusing words which the writer maybe has used them deliberately or accidentally. So we have to look at certain confusing words or words that carry unwanted meaning or excess of meaning in the place where it is not needed. So we have to take out those words, pick those words page by page. So deconstructionists don't read a book very regularly. They are a kind of random reader. So they just turn pages and pick words. So they pick, and that is how they collect those words and keep them for study. So this is one level of deconstructing the book. We should remember here that some of the critics also criticize this theory. They say that deconstruction is nothing but destruction. But when you start acting as a deconstructionist theorist, you literally argue with that kind of a argument, because it's not in any way destruction of it. It is a kind of a beautiful analysis which is quite new to the old tradition. So this is a kind of an experimentation of the book which would come out with multiple layers of meaning. So now this is the verbal level. You have worked on the words. The words that really interest you, or the words that really confuse you, or the words that carry some ambiguous meaning, or the words that stand as paradoxes. So you have simply picked those books, words for study. And coming to the second level, that is the textual level. So you will come across, again random way, you will come across certain sentences which literally don't stand well there, or which are literally forced there, or something is being said by the sentence but it means simply something else. So this can also be deliberately made by the writer, or he must have left it to the intervention, up to the intervention of the readers. So in order to know what exactly is there in the sentences, so I'll give a kind of a sentences. She went to the river simply to return back. So what is this? She went to the river simply to return back. This means going to a river is having a momentum in life. It's flowing. That is, it is moving ahead. So with the aspiration of going ahead in life, she went to the river, but suddenly she returned back to her static position. So normally when you look at this sentence, it's just like going and coming back. But there is a kind of a philosophical and a way and a different kind of an aesthetic meaning hidden in it, which on the textual level, deconstructionist theorist looks at it, picks such sentences and studies. Now, coming to the third level, this is the linguistic level, which is quite confusing. Again, you have to have a mastery over the language that you are with. If it is an English book, you have to have mastery on the linguistic aspects of this language. So now you have poets like Emily Dickinson, whose poems often carry strange punctuation marks. So she is used to, or rather addicted to, dashes and a kind of parenthesis, and she also uses some words, simple words with a capital letter in between, simply to make us concentrate on those words wherein she thinks is supplying extra meaning, or she is supporting those words. But it could not be the same from the deconstruction point of view. That particular word or that particular punctuation literally stands for the opposite meaning. Maybe she is in a way trying to give it a positive note to it, but then it is literally giving us some negative meaning. So even from the linguistic point of view, there are certain things which simply confuse us. So we have to concentrate on these things and pick. So the verbal level, the textual level, and the linguistic level, these are the three levels as foundation for a deconstructionist to approach a literary text. So at the verbal level also, what is it that gives you a kind of a paradox, a feeling, is that there are some abstract words used like love, truth. Since Derrida comes from the philosophical background, he knows how difficult it is to interpret abstract words which don't come into the arena of logical reasoning. So they are a kind of words which are above human understanding. They fall into the metaphysics. Now here, with having studied all these three levels, let us see, even Aristotle, who founded this literary theory in his Poetics, was also a philosopher. And how is it that he was so much interested in giving such a beautiful place for a literary art in his book Poetics? So even Derrida is a philosopher, Aristotle is a philosopher. They must have that reasoning capacities in them. How is it that Aristotle was so much inclined towards a kind of artistic inventory? So now we should see that, of course, Aristotle was a philosopher with his logical reasoning in the field of philosophy. But then when he came to literature, he was damn sure that literature will also stand for truth, as philosophy, which also stands for abstract things, and literature will have a different way of approaching the truth. So what is this different way? With the help of mimesis, or with the help of representation of natural things, it will sum up its theory and come to a truth that is quite acceptable to the people, because that truth teaches the readers ought to be kind of a life. So what you are now, so you will be made better using that literary text or that literary criticism. So this is how two philosophers at this point vary here. So Derrida, of course, had a fight with Aristotle, but Aristotle's theory was quite clear up to 19th century. But this is again a kind of a fight between theories rather than an attack on the traditional era. This is what I would like to say. Hybridization, I would not love to pick any kind of a thing that was there in the classical tradition. Hybridization, I would call only between the modern theories. How each theory is trying to either support or attack the other theory, and having totally a kind of a confused situation in the text. So these are the three levels that will help deconstruct to look at the literary text. Now it is very difficult on the surface level to say how is it that we enter into a text like this. So now we have to take a certain thing and experiment this deconstruction over it. So what I thought, let me pick W.B. Yeats' Sailing to Byzantium. It's a kind of a narrative poem, of course written in 1927, when people were confused about the European ideals, when people were almost coming to conclusions that all the cultural and the literary theories introduced by the Europeans or the classical masters posed simply Hippocratic. So because of the world wars, because of the extreme colonization, because of the discrimination that was found between continents, because of the white and black war, people in Europe and outside Europe had posed a kind of a challenge with the European traditions, culture and their literary outputs. So this is how W.B. Yeats was also affected by these drawbacks of the European continent. So in his Sailing to Byzantium, so actually from the surface level we see the theme of Sailing to Byzantium is the human imperfection versus the perfection of art. So now let us, without wasting time, focus on the poem. So I would like to pick one or two aspects from this poem because it is too much of a controversial poem. Now he says, he looks at the sages who are already there in Byzantium and he invokes those sages and tells them to cleanse his heart. So as a deconstructionist, what is my duty to look there? So why is it that W.B. Yeats, keep the author aside, why is it that word like cleanse the heart is written? So always the heart stands for purity. The mind is often corrupted, but the heart is always pure. So why is it that the author wants, instead of cleansing his mind, he wants the sage to cleanse his heart? That means since his participation into a kind of a patriotic struggle in England or his meeting with Maud Gonne, maybe that kind of a situation he had was literally disconnected with the theories of European continent or with the culture of European continent. He wanted to cleanse his heart because he was an English person, he was an Irish person. So now this is one thing, and on the other outlook, he wants a sage to clean his heart. And why is it not, he is not asking for a saint to cleanse his heart? Because overall we consider that a sage is a very wise man, whereas a saint is a very innocent man, very less learned man, but one who is true to his life, one who is true to his policies of life. So a sage could have a family, whereas a saint normally doesn't have a family. So even there is a kind of a disagreement when it comes to picking of a sage and not picking a saint. So this is a kind of a deconstructionist outlook we can have on this particular sentence. Cleansing, for example, if you as a person or I as a person had gotten the opportunity of getting all that we desired in our life, and the heart was in a kind of a fulfilled state, in a very happy state, having had the experience, the beauties of life, we would never ask anyone to cleanse the heart. So to reach the salvation, it is not really necessary for someone to cleanse the heart and then reach the doors of salvation. So heart itself being a pure entity, why was it that Yeats, instead of picking the mind, picked the concept of heart there? Because in those ages, in the 20th century, the mind was of course corrupted, but even the heart was corrupted, which was waiting to be cleansed by the sages who were wise. I don't know whether they were honest, but by the sages who were wise, who knew how to deal with the situation. So look at the difference of meaning immediately you come across here. And in some other line, he uses this phrase, a paltry thing. An old man is nothing but a paltry thing. So when an old man is seen from the poet's point of view, he is posed as an ugly thing. But then what is a paltry thing? He compares the old man to a scarecrow. So why do we use the scarecrows in the fields? To scare the unwanted parasites. It could be birds or it could be any other animals. So in order to scare the animals and to protect something that is very much there, the sanctity of the field, we use the scarecrow. But then now simultaneously W.B. Yeats calls the old man as a scarecrow and as an ugly creature unable to do something. But then this is not the meaning inside it. Having had all the experience of life, having been rich with experience, he already knows as an old man to scare those people who want to force certain things and theories or any other culture upon him. So when you become old, you're kind of an independent being. So irrespective of the beauty that you have or the loss of beauty that you're suffering, you're a very happy person because it is in the old age that you have come to accept yourself in the fullest possible form on one side. And opposite to the paltry thing, if you consider a youth as a very beautiful thing, king. But then imagine the kind of suffering that an youth faces in order to maintain the intactness of the beauty of his heart, mind, body and spirit. Since he is not still reached the areas of maturity, somewhere all his youth and adulthood is spent in suffering, and that is really the ugliest stage of a man. And this is how we have to compare. It is not the old man who is ugly, looks a paltry thing, but inside he is a scarecrow. In the sense, he is far more experienced to shoo all the unwanted things from life. So now that WBH has become old, he considers himself a paltry thing from outside, but a scarecrow, a wise person from inside, has to be studied from different points of view. Having had all the experience of life, nothing left to learn or experience, he is happy going to Byzantium. So his journey is a kind of a happy journey. So it is not merely for the salvation that he wants to go there, but he is contented with what he had in his life, and that is how he is going to Byzantium. So this is how we have to deconstruct a poem. We have to pick and dismantle the things from each other. It could be a kind of a binary opposition that was there with Ferdinand Saussure. But then it is something more. So the knowledge and the outlook you will get into a poem only once you have that literary interest and then come to a kind of a evaluation. So now he also speaks about, by the end of the poem, he also speaks about human imperfection versus the perfection of art. But doing so, according to me, what W.B. Yeats has done in almost all his poems, he calls his artistry or he calls his poems or his themes as very inferior to the great people of the great tradition. But then through his poems, somehow he wants to be immortalized, and he is an art himself. So making his own self immortal in the by the way of writing such beautiful poems, he has made himself an art. So the human perfection is already left behind, and he is almost on the part of the art, which is on the perfection side. So when he simply says that the theme of the poem is human imperfection versus perfection of the art, that is just the surfacial thing that we come across. But when you enter into what he is trying to say, a person like W.B. Yeats was almost on the side of perfection level or the perfection side. So what he wanted to tell is to the people who were following him, or the people who were literally opposing him, or all those people who were trying to negate the essence of literature. So the imperfection of human is not a poet, is not a poetry or a theory, but all those people who were wanting to put unwanted pressure on literature and trying to make it a very frail kind of a thing. Studying literature could never be a kind of a destruction theory. So deconstruction literally means reconstructing it, analysis of a poem in a far more modern, thoughtful, mixing philosophy and literary tradition together. So now you will come to know the value of Jacques Derrida, who is considered to be the most difficult person to understand, because throughout his life, he wrote about 40 books and around more than 200 articles, but he never ever tried to give the definition of deconstruction. That is why I also don't have a kind of a definition for that, because Derrida believed in life that when you give a definition to something, you're literally shifting from the core meaning of it. All those people who have to try to define things and to try to reach the truth, or have tried to reach an ultimatum or a conclusion, have always shifted from the truth, because this is the nature of man. The shifts that you find in a literary text, the breaks and the pauses of a writer that you find in a literary text, themselves show how man can never reach a kind of a perfection state. So when he begins, when a writer begins with his language, he is there. But somewhere at some point of time, he immediately takes a pause. So the beautiful signifiers that were coming out suddenly have a pause. So you cannot define anything so easily. So the mere meaning of a definition is lost in the theory of deconstruction. So this is something something very beautiful. So the more you deconstruct a literary piece or a work of art, the more wise and intelligent as a literary scholar you become. So this is what I wanted to convey along with understanding the theory of deconstruction. Hope you enjoyed, dear students. Thank you.